one-on-one in the Oval Office, San Diego's mayor urges President Trump to protect cross-border business. For thousands of asylum seekers, the journey to the U.S. starts in Honduras. Why so many are choosing to leave their home country. Plus, was it murder or mutiny? Navy SEAL Eddie Gallagher goes on trial, and surprise testimony adds a new twist to the case. I'm Mark Sauer. The KPBS Roundtable starts now. Welcome to our discussion of the week's top stories. I'm Mark Sauer. And joining me at the KPBS Roundtable today, Michael Smolens, columnist with the San Diego Union-Tribune, reporter Maya Srikrishnan of Voice of San Diego, and Tony Perry, former San Diego bureau chief for the Los Angeles Times. Well, it was a surprise invitation for San Diego Mayor Kevin Faulconer. Come into the Oval Office and chat with President Trump. They talked about several important topics, according to a White House press release. But immigration and the humanitarian crisis at the southern border were not among them. And Michael, start with, why was San Diego's mayor in Washington? Who did he plan to meet with?
Well, there were a couple things going on. There was the conference of the Border Trade Alliance, which is what you would expect, a group of businesses, governments, and academics that want to facilitate cross-border commerce, both at the southern and northern border. So he's been part of that for some time. He also had meetings with White House or administration staff members of the intergovernmental affairs staff to talk about trade, but also a fix of the border sewage problem that we've had that's been going on for generations. And he also had meetings with members of Congress lined up for those issues as well.
So how did this meeting with Trump come about?
Well, according to the mayor, he was meeting with Trump's staff, on the intergovernmental relations folks, and word came through that the president wanted to meet him. So after the meeting, he went over to the Oval Office and had an interesting 19 minutes, it seems like, with the mayor. So okay. It wasn't a very long time, but a lot happened.
In a photo op, and a lot happened. Well, what were some of the topics that Faulconer and Trump talked about then?
Well, it sort of depends on who is talking.
Yeah, we'll get to that in a minute. Yeah.
The mayor, I did interview the mayor before a lot of things changed in the public perception, but he emphasized those issues. He knew time was short, and he wanted to talk about trade, and particularly urged the ratification of the U.S.-Mexico-Canada agreement, which would replace NAFTA. And, of course, that's the administration's pact. They're pushing to have it, so he really emphasized that. He also talked about just the importance of his view. I mean, he's a free trader, of free trade and how tariffs really can hurt San Diego. But he thought, in his view, to give the president some on-the-ground examples of what really happens here and how that works might be helpful. But also, he really stressed the need for federal funding for border solutions on this whole Tijuana sewage spill. As you know, it goes into the Tijuana River Valley and out to the ocean and closes beaches along Imperial Beach.
And we've talked about that a lot on the show. It's been a crime
problem
for many years.
But now, as we know, that the president went on TV and said something different.
Yeah, let's get into that. So he talked with his favorite cable TV pal, Sean Hannity, the president did, after he had met with Mayor Faulconer. And here's what Trump claimed the mayor told him in that meeting.
We just finished San Diego, as you know, San Diego and California. They're so happy. The mayor was just up in my office. Great guy, and he came up to thank me for having done the wall because it's made such a difference. He said it's like day and night. He said people are flowing across, and now nobody can come in.
Well, good to know that San Diego's in California. Glad to clear that up for us. But Michael Faulconer, through spokesman Craig Gustafson, our old pal from the UT days, said the president might not have been entirely truthful about what they actually talked about.
Well, he was more emphatic. He said the mayor did not say that.
Exactly.
I talked with or communicated with White House communication staff. There's no transcript of this, so we don't really know what was said. But the release you mentioned that put out by the White House, they talked about, they gave a summary of what was discussed, and it was basically the points that the mayor talked about, trade, the USMCA agreement, and the border sewage aspect of it. I would have to think that if the wall came up and if the mayor said anything like what the president said, he said, that would have been reflected. It's such a hot button key issue. So, you know, you could call this a he said, she said, but it seems Very out of character for the mayor, who's been critical of the expanded wall.
Wrote an op-ed in your paper before Trump came here to look at the prototypes. And we've got another lie in that statement, frankly, but by the president, which was the wall he's taking credit for. We go back to 1994 and Operation Gatekeeper. We've had a wall here for a long time, a couple of walls, long
even
before
the wall
Trump.
That they built recently was approved before this president.
And replacements and, such, and they brought the military down and didn't really do much except some wire. I'm not surprised. I mean, the Washington Post has pointed out, what, more than 10,000 lies and prevarications and distortions by the President of the United States. But what about Faulconer? Is he immune to the idea that sometimes there's a moral imperative that takes precedence over sewage and tariffs, et cetera? Well, I mean, what's going on at the border and the children, et cetera?
It's interesting because I had asked him, you know, just the night before. I mean, you think this meeting was in a peculiar time. The night before, Trump tweeted out that we're going to be deporting millions of unauthorized immigrants next week. And then after the meeting, he went on to his reelection campaign kickoff where he, you know, talked about immigration in the way he usually does. And so I asked the mayor, did you discuss immigration or particularly the fact that he's threatening to deport millions of people? And that has been an issue with the mayor because he hasn't out and out opposed enforcement measures, but he says some extreme measures really are disruptive to the community and cause a lot of severe dislocation. He just said sort of blandly, it didn't come up. He sort of viewed that 19 minutes was, or whatever time he had, was going to be pretty short, and he wanted to emphasize those key issues.
Well, that's a good segue for us. We have a little sound with the mayor here. KPBS caught up with him this week and talking about exactly what you're talking about. Let's hear that.
Spoke with him for 19 minutes. Why didn't you bring up the issue of immigration, and particularly being the mayor of San Diego with such a large population?
We really had the opportunity to focus a brief time on USMCA and how important trade is here in San Diego, and 100,000 jobs that are at stake. And so it was an opportunity for me to speak directly, obviously, with the president and some of his team about how important cross-border trade is and why we absolutely have to keep this going. Tariffs are the wrong way to go. Free trade is works for San Diego. We know how to do it. We know how to compete. And so for me to be able to talk about that directly, this is an important time for us. We have to get USMCA through the United States House of Representatives and the Senate. It's the right thing to do for San Diego. It's the right thing to do for our country. A lot of jobs at stake.
I wonder if he
didn't answer the question, did he?
I wonder if he leaned in and said, don't take Peter Navarro at his word, because Peter, former San Diegan, mayoral candidate, professor, et cetera, is, as far as we can tell, the man on tariffs and such, and he's got the president's ear. I wonder if Kevin said, don't always listen to him. There's a different viewpoint on the border.
Well, he certainly didn't want to touch that hot-button immigration issue.
True, and he's been taking heat for that. I think that the reality of it is, like, he's the only Republican mayor of a big U.S. city. He differs with the president on a lot of issues, and that's been reflected in the national press. Is he going to spend that time to beat his head against, a wall, so to speak, on immigration, where he knows where Trump's coming from, or try to make headway on other issues that he's concerned about? He did, I don't know if confront, but you mentioned tariffs and Peter Navarro. I mean, the mayor has been outspoken against tariffs and the ones that are enacted and are being proposed by the president, and he felt it was important to stress why free trade really works here, in his view, because obviously the president has a different view of that.
I wanted to bring up, before we leave this segment, climate change, another issue where Faulconer strongly differs with Trump. President's a climate change denier. He directed the EPA just this week, front page of the New York Times today, to ease restriction of coal-burning power plants. Faulconer runs a big coastal city, aggressive plan to limit carbon emissions. Didn't confront Trump on this existential
Well, but, issue. Okay, look, I feel like I'm defending the mayor to a great degree here. You've got maybe 20 minutes with the president. How many other issues didn't he bring up that we could do that?
That's true.
And again, that's an issue that the president is so far in the different direction. Are you going to make a statement? Is that the point of the mayor? I mean, he has said that his job is to represent San Diego's interests. Those are San Diego's interests, but he felt that he could make headway on those particular issues. Is that right or wrong? I don't know, but it's certainly in a political sense, I think it's understandable that you're not going to waste time on something where you're just not going to get anywhere.
I don't ever see Kevin as a good candidate for a profile and courage chapter in a book, but it does seem that there are some times in which you have to set aside issues and say, human beings here, we're talking human beings, children, right on our doorstep, and it's your policy. The
Although today he tried to blame Obama again for that policy.
The tariffs and the sewage, those are probably being dealt at a lower level. But the immigration and the hardcore issue, that comes right from Donald Trump's mouth. And our mayor had a chance to say something.
All right. Well, we'll get off the mayor here, but we'll stay with immigration. We're going to move on to our next topic. Violent crackdowns by a corrupt government, starvation wages, rampant gang violence. These are among the conditions in Honduras causing many thousands to trek to our southern border with hope of a decent life. Refugees and caravans from that troubled country, plus neighboring Guatemala and El Salvador, have crossed Mexico in recent years to plead their cases. Most are detained and sent back. But Maya, you went to Honduras to see conditions for yourself there this month. Start with that trip. How did it come about? What was the purpose?
Well, so as everyone's heard, you know, there were these large caravans of mainly Hondurans that ended up in Tijuana last year, thousands of thousands of Hondurans. And in my immigration coverage, I was constantly talking to people at the border, and I decided that, you know, I wanted to go to the country and see for myself why so many people are leaving. Because when we look at numbers at the border, Guatemalans are coming at the largest raw numbers, but the highest rate of migration is actually from Hondurans. So that means that there are more people proportionally leaving the country than in Guatemala. And that's pretty significant.
In one of your dispatches, you featured a young man, Denelson, if I'm pronouncing that correctly. Tell us about him, your experience, and how you met him and caught up with him again after he'd been sent back.
So he traveled with the caravan that ended up in Tijuana in November to come here, and I met him there at a shelter. And he crossed about a month later and ended up in detention, and we lost touch. But one of his friends, who I had also met at the time, was deported pretty quickly back. And he reached out to me via Facebook. And when I figured out that I was going to be able to go to Honduras, we connected, and it turned out that Denelson was going to be deported around the same time that I was going to be there. So he was actually deported the day before I arrived there. And we met back up so he could kind of talk to me about his experience over the past 5 months since I had last seen him.
And what's he plan to do now? He's made this long, dangerous journey here. He got deported back. And is this typical, would you say, of a lot of people you've interviewed who've done this same thing?
I mean, when I was there, it was, you know, we see deportation numbers, but it was really startling because just in San Pedro Sula, so that's one city, there are also planes of deportees that come to Tegucigalpa, which is the capital. But, you know, twice a week there were planes of hundreds of people deported just to that city from the U.S. And then on top of that, there were planes and buses nearly every day of the week coming in from Mexico. So there are thousands of people being returned to this country every single week.
Yeah, and so that these stories over and over and over again, they've made the trek, and the numbers are difficult. We were talking before the show about the Reuters a story today, but the vast majority of these folks don't get their asylum claims granted, and they're going back to these triangle countries, right?
What is that, Michael? You know,
just the arduous trip, the expense of the trip, and then to get deported back, or even to a different city. Can you describe what the frustration must be? But just because it's such a desperate situation that they're leaving, and after all that, to be back at square one, you know, I'm sure some people say, oh, they should know better, but nonetheless, it's a human thing, and it's got to be just horrible.
Yeah, it was crazy. One day I actually went to when the plane landed, and I kind of accompanied a group of people who came off, and a lot of them went to the bus station, and they just, they get a paid bus ticket, which they're supposed to use to go back to their town or to go wherever they need to. And a lot of them just got back on a bus back to the border.
So they're not
to the border.
They keep trying.
Yeah, and I think that really speaks to the desperation. And I literally heard from people that, you know, we feel like we're going to die in our country, so we might as well die trying to have another opportunity.
Are the problems, poverty, corruption, criminality, so endemic there that there's not a thing we can do on this side of the border to rectify any
right.
of those
What's your impression of conditions, exactly right, of that could be improved to maybe keep folks there and start to thrive in their own homes?
So, you know, poverty and violence were the two reasons that people cited the most when I was talking about why people leave. And one of the things that was really clear was that underlying those were issues of vast corruption in the country. So, you know, there's very little money being spent on education or health care. Even some of the money that's being spent for security to kind of deal with some of the violence or trust in police, because a lot of times, you know, impunity is really high there. So if someone you know is murdered it's very unlikely that that's going to be investigated if you report it to the police, and you may even face retaliation for it. And so I think that until those underlying problems of corruption are solved, it's very, very difficult to solve those things, even just through foreign aid, because you can send the money, but you don't actually know that that's getting to the people to fix an education system or something like that.
And if the U.S. stops sending aid, as the President of the United States has threatened, will that work or just boomerang?
I mean, I think that would also make things worse, because it would just further destabilize the country. Even though not all of that money is getting to where it should. I mean, if you are taking out that quantity of money from a country that is that dire, it also leaves like a big vacuum.
Any sense that this thing that we hear, that many of them are being told, here, take a kid, and if you arrive at the border with a kid, you can get in the country, even if you don't know the kid and he's not a relative. Did you sense any of that, that there's kind of a take-a-kid syndrome?
There's definitely a lot of rumors, you know, and there's businesses, you know, of coyotes who are trying to respond to what the U.S. is doing to get people there. It's a business for them. And then there's a lot of rumors among people about what they need to do or what they can do to get there. The child thing definitely did come up. There are some people, especially people out in the rural areas, who seem to not fully understand at this point that if you travel with a child that is not your own, you will be separated and it's not going to work out that way. You know, but a lot of people are also traveling with their families just because they're that desperate at this point.
Everybody leaves.
Yeah, I mean, there's like a mass exodus from that country at this
point. So what you're sort of suggesting is it's exaggerated on this side of the border, that there's a rent-a-kid syndrome down there.
I think it happens, but I don't think it's the only thing. I think it happens in certain places with people who take coyotes. But when we're talking about, like, the caravans, for example, people are taking those so that they don't have to use coyotes. They're taking those because they're cheaper and they can still travel safely, you know, if they travel in numbers and they save up their money to take buses and things like that.
You going back?
So in those situations, I mean, I'd like to if we continue seeing these numbers of
Absolutely.
People, you know. It's good to understand what's happening there.
Few seconds left in this segment. We were into a national debate, of course, presidential year. A lot of candidates. Any likely have any meaningful national debate in this election year about what might be done regionally to really make a difference in these triangle countries?
We'll see. I mean, not even every candidate has put out, you know, immigration reforms or anything like that.
Any
I think
kind of plan.
Julian Castro has, and maybe one other Democratic candidate.
It's surprisingly few, given there's almost two dozen of them.
Yeah, and considering it's such a big issue for Donald Trump, but, you know, we'll see whether it turns into anything.
Well, another close thing to watch in this very complicated, tragic issue. Well, we are going to move on. If a Navy medic is to be believed, it wasn't Navy SEAL Eddie Gallagher who killed an ISIS fighter while being treated in Iraq for a leg wound. It was the medic himself. The bombshell exploded on prosecutors this week in Gallagher's closely watched trial for war crimes. In addition to murder charges, the SEAL leader is also accused of firing indiscriminately at civilians and intimidating potential witnesses against him. And witnesses, fellow Navy SEALs, said under oath they fear retaliation for coming forward. Now, Tony, you've covered military murder trials here. How unusual is it to see these Navy SEALs be the key witnesses against one of their own?
It's unusual, but it's not unprecedented. Early on in the war against the Iraqis, Iraqi leadership, there were upward of 10 SEALs from Coronado investigated for crimes much similar to those that are alleged here, abusing prisoners, intimidating people, and indeed, there was a death involved of one prisoner. And there was a court-martial of one of the SEALs, a lieutenant. He was found innocent, by the way. So it's happened, but the SEALs tend to be, well, not tend to be, are extraordinarily secretive. You're a reporter. You can call up the Army, Navy, Marine Corps and say, hey, I want to come and see what you're doing. And you go through some hoops and suddenly you're there taking notes on what the 19-year-olds are doing and what the lieutenants are doing. Not so the SEALs. They are very, very secretive. So we only occasionally get a glimpse into what they're really like. Now, what we're getting a glimpse of here in the Gallagher case is probably not what they're always like. It's probably the aberrational. But we are seeing it unvarnished, disputes between groups of SEALs, some that thought Gallagher was great, some who thought he was a maniac and they had to do something. And then, of course, testimony by SEALs, and we'll have more testimony by SEALs against him. So unusual, And as Steve Walsh's story pointed out, that was a blockbuster of a piece of evidence where that medic said, I saw him stab him once. Now, he had said when he was interviewed by the investigators two or three times, but he's winnowed it down to, I saw him stab him once. And
but that wasn't the fatal wound. Yeah.
But he wasn't dead. I pinched off the breathing tube. Now, as again,
so what happened here? How in the world are prosecutors surprised by this testimony?
As Steve Wells points out, the prosecutors were irate. Well, this SEAL had been given immunity. What if he's not given immunity? And he gets on the stand and he says, Fifth Amendment, you get nothing. So here, prosecution got, yes, I saw him stab in the neck a defenseless teenager, basically. We don't know exactly who he was because there were no name, no autopsy or anything, which is kind of typical of these cases.
It is. That was another question.
So you get that, but then you get this other. But and of course, the prosecutors will do their best to say that he's a liar and that he's lying. Now,
he being this medic who claims
exactly,
he killed him.
On the jury, seven members of the jury, five Marines, two sailors. Now, they're all going to have a view of what it's really like in a combat zone.
Yeah, six of them, I think, are combat veterans specifically.
Yeah, exactly. And it only takes two-thirds, by the way, for conviction. They'll vote once, and that is it. None of this two and three votes like civilians. No hung juries. You do one vote. If you've got enough for a conviction, it's a conviction. If not, we move on. Mm-hmm. We have a lot more to go. The accusations, as you noted, that Chief Gallagher was shooting indiscriminately as a sniper and hit maybe a young girl and an old man with a white beard. We're going to hear about that. I think we'll also hear, again, this is different. This isn't downtown San Diego.
Yeah, let's talk about that a little bit.
I presume that we may hear, well, who really knows this? Who were those people who got hit? And then, of course, they're going to have to throw their hands up and say, well, we really don't know. Welcome to the difficulty of investigating one of these things and bringing it to trial. And then somebody may say, well, what were the rules of engagement? We all know who've been in war zones that sometimes people you don't think are dangerous. And that can be young women and that can be old men. Did Gallagher think that these two might be dangerous or not? That depends on whether he actually testifies and says, yeah, I shot him, but here's why.
Tony,
so we're going to learn a lot about what it was like.
This was Thursday was a bad day for the prosecution. They get blindsided. But yeah, this isn't the first problem they've had. They've had issues. How are they handling the case? It seems like there's been a few things that just like have blown up on them.
Well, I said that this was unusual but not unprecedented. I'll tell you what was unprecedented. That stuff about putting a little glip into a document given to the defense because they could then, the prosecution could figure out who were they sharing these documents. Were they giving it to those dreadful people in the press or not? That's another oddity of the system. Things that on a federal court downtown, we could go and get right there in the file and we'd look at it and write our little stories. You can't get those documents, so they have to be leaked to you. Very difficult. Their system looks like a civilian system. It is not.
And also, you're not seeing prelims, you're not seeing testimony pre-trial that would shed light on a lot of these issues?
You should. There can be prelims. There can be what they call an Article 32. Right. I don't believe there was in this case. Now, don't forget, over everything is the commander-in-chief. And he has already made noises about looking to pardon some military personnel convicted of what we call war crimes. He's out there, and one of his former attorneys, by the way, is part of the case and is helping the defense. So,
Trump's former attorneys.
Trump's. Yeah. If there is a conviction, and I'm not sure there's going to be, the President of the United States, acting as Commander-in-Chief, could pardon Chief Gallagher immediately. So we've got a long way to go here, and if there is a conviction, we have an even longer way to go.
Well, I did want to play a bite here from Gallagher's attorney, Tim Parlatore, I think his name is, and here's his theory on the whole case and the defense.
The whole theme of our opening, the theme of our case, that this is not a murder, this is a mutiny. This is a group of young, disgruntled sailors that didn't like being told that they were cowards, and so they decided to conspire to take down the chief. They made up a story, and that's why we're here.
that's young disgruntled sailors. That's not our image of SEALs.
No, it is not. It is, however, a fairly standard defense piece of
strategy
defense.
In this. Yeah. This
defense seems to be based on two things, which are classic and used all the time. One, those people making these accusations, they're just disgruntled failures, and they're just mad at the real fighters that they were tough. And then two, there was a lousy investigation. Those are classic. They were used. I referenced a case against 10 SEALs that came to one being sent to court-martial. That was the defense there. And he was, that lieutenant was found innocent, even though a SEAL and a CIA operative claimed to have seen him do things. But yet the six on the jury, all SEALs in that case, found him innocent. Why, we don't know, because part of the system by culture is that the jury members never speak publicly, yeah. And they certainly don't talk to the hounds of the press.
Well, we're out of time, but we're going to watch that. We're going to go on for a couple more weeks. We'll see what happens in that trial. Fascinating case. And that does wrap up another week of stories at the KPBS Roundtable. I'd like to thank my guest, Michael Smullins of the San Diego Union-Tribune, Maya Srikrishnan, a voice of San Diego, and Tony Perry, former San Diego bureau chief for the Los Angeles Times. And a reminder, all of the stories we discussed today available on our website, kpbs.org. I'm Mark Sauer. Thanks for joining us today, and join us again next week on the Roundtable.